Welcome to First English Lutheran Church of Dorset. I'm so thankful and joyful that you have been able to join us this morning for worship, that you're part of our family this morning watching worship. A few things about our church, just so you know. We are a confessional Lutheran church. What we believe, teach, and confess is that the Bible is the inspired and inerrant Word of God, free from error, completely God's Word in every sense. We also believe that we don't interpret the Bible. Scripture interprets Scripture. We learn God's Word, and in places He teaches us what His Word means as we follow along and stay in His Word. We also believe every bit of what Scripture teaches about who we are as fallen human beings. When Adam and Eve sinned and brought sin into the world, it means every person is conceived and born sinful and in need, desperate need of only what Christ did for us in His death and resurrection, His perfect life in our place. We believe in 6 days of creation. We believe what the Bible says. The earth was created in 6 normal days, not billions and millions of years ago. We don't believe in evolution because it's not what God teaches. We believe in the order of creation. We believe that Adam was created first and then Eve. We don't believe this makes men and women unequal in any way. We just believe that God has a plan, a vocation for each of us in our place, who we are as men and women. And we believe that Christ's true body and blood are present in the sacrament, not symbolically, not in some way that means His body and blood. Truly, He gives us His body and blood to eat and to drink for the forgiveness of sins and for the strengthening of our faith. We also hold to the fact that baptism means what the Lord says it is. When we're baptized into Christ, we are baptized into His death and resurrection. It truly happened. We died with Christ and we rose again with Him. And each and every day that we wake to remember our baptism, we are leading the repentant life that our Lord calls us to. As Luther says in the very first of the 95 Theses, when our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ says repent, He wills the entire life of a Christian be one of repentance. We also believe, so importantly, that God's Word actually does what it says. We're sacramental Christians. When we hear His Word proclaimed, when His gospel promises are delivered, when we hear His Word taught to us and explained, as you will shortly in the sermon throughout all of the liturgy, we know that the Lord is working through us, through His Word, delivering His gifts, giving us what He says, forgiving us, and giving us eternal life. So again, welcome to worship here at First English Lutheran Church. God bless your day in Christ.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Happy 4th of July. Blessed Independence Day. At the end of the service, when we go through announcements, we're going to have everybody that served in the armed forces. I'll mention the name of the armed forces and have you stand up so we can recognize your service to our country. So, with that, a couple of special prayers. Paula Roberts has been having some heart problems. Again, I noticed last week that Paula had put a stent of some kind or something like that put in her heart. So our thoughts and prayers are with Paula and Pastor. Our pastor suffers from heart disease anyway, so there's a lot going on in the family, but our thoughts and prayers are with them. And also, our prayers are with Priscilla, Johanning, Tim, Johanning, Susan Rugrove, and the whole family at the loss of Priscilla's son, Tom. Tom finally succumbed to pancreatic cancer this week. And so he's with home with the Lord. His funeral, if you are able to attend or wanted to know, the funeral is at the United Methodist Church in Park Rapids, Riverside, at 11 o'clock on Tuesday. 11 o'clock on Tuesday. So again, our thoughts and prayers are with Priscilla and Tim and the whole family. With that, we take all our prayers to our Lord, knowing He hears and answers them. And we begin this morning by singing our opening hymn, "In Adam We Have All Been One," hymn 569. Consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as His people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking His grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner.
Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life.
friends, Almighty God in His mercy has given His Son to die for you, and for His sake He forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by His authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now join together in reading our introit for this morning, which is found in your service bulletin insert. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good.
Blessed is the man who takes refuge in Him.
For the Lord has chosen Zion.
He has desired it for His dwelling place.
This is my resting place forever.
Here I will dwell, for I have desired it.
I will abundantly bless her provisions.
I will satisfy her poor with bread.
Her priests I will clothe with salvation.
And her saints will shout for joy. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
O taste and see that the Lord is good.
Blessed is the man who takes refuge in Him.
Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated. A reading from the Lutheran Confessions comes from Article 12 of the Apology of the Augsburg Confession concerning confession and satisfaction. Therefore, troubles are not always punishments or signs of God's wrath. Indeed, terrified consciences should be taught that there are more important purposes for afflictions, so that they do not think that God is rejecting them when they see nothing but God's punishment and anger in troubles. The other more important purposes are to be considered. That is, that God is doing His strange or alien work so that He may be able to do His own proper work, as Isaiah 28 teaches in a long speech. When the disciples asked about the blind man who sinned, Christ replies, the cause of his blindness is not sin, but that the works of God might be displayed in him. In Jeremiah, it is said, if those who did not deserve to drink the cup must drink it, so the prophets John the Baptist and other saints were killed. Therefore, troubles are not always punishment for certain past deeds, but they are God's work, intended for our benefit, and that God's power might be made more apparent in our weakness. So Paul says God's strength is made perfect in weakness, 2 Corinthians 12:9. A reading from our Lutheran confession. And now Robin asked me to relate to you guys that if this hymn he is about to sing, the tune should be familiar. If you want to jump in and sing with him, he would love to have that. Against me. They and their fathers have transgressed against me to this very day. The descendants also are impudent and stubborn. I send you to them, and you shall say to them, thus says the Lord God. And whether they hear or refuse to hear, for they are a rebellious house, they will know that a prophet has been among them. This is the word of the Lord. Speaking the truth, but I refrain from it so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from becoming too elated by the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest on me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. When I am weak, then I am strong." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Teach in the synagogue. And many who heard him were astonished, saying, "Where did this man get these things? What is the wisdom given to him? How are such mighty works done by his hands? Is not this the carpenter,
the son of Mary, the brother of James and Joseph and Judas and Simon? And are not his sisters here with us? And they took offense at him. And Jesus said to them, a prophet is not without honor, except in his hometown, and among his relatives, and in his own household. And he could do mighty work there. He could do no mighty work there, forgive me, except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them. And he marveled because of their unbelief. And he went about among the villages teaching. And he called the 12 and began to send them out, two by two, and gave them authority over unclean spirits. He charged them to take nothing for their journey except the staff, no bread, no bag, no money in their belts, but to wear sandals and not put on two tunics. And he said to them, whenever you enter a house, stay there until you depart from there. And if any place will not receive you, and they will not listen to you, when you leave, shake off the dust that is on your feet as a testimony against them. So they went out and proclaimed that people should repent. And they cast out many demons and anointed with oil many who were sick and healed them. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
I believe in one God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things
this Independence Day and always, grace, peace, and mercy be yours. From God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. This was a special day for me because my favorite passage of Scripture was our epistle reading. But I couldn't figure out what I wanted to preach on, that or the gospel. And I decided, since they really proclaim the same message, I could fit them both in. So, with that, I want to read for you a couple passages, a couple verses from both 2 Corinthians 12 and from Mark 6. St. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians 12, what I consider to be the second gospel in a nutshell. To keep me from becoming conceited because of these surpassingly great revelations, there was given me a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, in insults, in hardship, in persecution, and in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." And from Mark chapter 6, verses 3 through 6. The people of Nazareth speaking about Jesus. "Isn't this the carpenter? Isn't this Mary's son and the brother of James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon? Aren't his sisters here with us?" And they took offense at him. Jesus said to them, "Only in his hometown, among his relatives, and in his own house is a prophet without honor. He could not do any miracles there, except lay his hands on a few sick people and heal them. And he was amazed at their lack of faith." You know, one of the favorite passages that people often pick for funerals, maybe one of the most beloved passages in all of Scripture, is from John chapter 14, where Jesus is comforting his disciples when he's talking about going away. And he talks about, "In my Father's house are many rooms, and they go to prepare a place for you." It's very comforting. It's requested at funerals all the time. And it's very fitting, this comfort of knowing that our Lord, everything he did was to prepare this room in heaven in our Father's house for us, and how that gets us through the difficult times. But you know, there's more to that. The room is prepared. Jesus prepared that room and finished it completely with his life, death, and resurrection. It is done. So when I'm asked by people, regularly asked, "Why am I still here, Pastor? If my room is ready, why am I still here?" And the best answer I can think of, and this applies to all of us, is that our room's ready, but we need to be made ready for our room. And that's really what the readings for today are all about. The Lord making us ready for our room that he's prepared. Now, it's 4th of July, and I would be, I think, remiss if I didn't say something related to that, share something patriotic, something to remind us of the wonderful grace and mercy that our Lord has given us by living in this country. So I want to share with you an account about a wonderful story. Now, this is familiar to all of you if you are familiar with the account of Easy Company. 506th Parachute Regiment, 2nd Battalion, 101st Airborne Division of the United States Army. And you might be familiar with Easy Company and their story if you've read the tremendous, and I can't recommend it highly enough, the tremendous book by Stephen Ambrose, called Band of Brothers. Wonderful. And if you haven't read the book, you might have watched the wonderful miniseries by the same name. If you are familiar, or if you're not, it won't make any difference, because I want to tell you this morning about the first commanding officer of Easy Company. His name was Lieutenant, then later Captain Herbert Sobel. Captain Sobel was a jerk. Captain Sobel was in many ways incompetent. The people hated him in the company. He was mean-spirited. He worked them to death over and over and over again. They had this mountain at the base that they were training. This is really the first para infantry or airborne troops of our country's history to fight in war. And they had to be trained properly, and they had to be trained in the correct way. And at the base that they were training at in Georgia, there was a mountain named Currahee. And it was about 3.5 miles to the top of that mountain at about a 90-degree angle, it looked like in the movie and what the book talks about. It was at just off base, and they would run that every day. Easy Company ran that Currahee route sometimes 3 or 4 times a day, more than anybody else. Captain Sobel would cancel any kind of liberty on the part of his troops at a moment's notice for almost anything. He was difficult to get along with. He treated everybody poorly, and he had him run that route to Currahee up and down more than any other company or unit in the regiment, by far. Infamously, one time, just to get back at his officers and troops in the company, he told Captain Richard Winters, who's really the hero of Easy Company, that he was mess officer, to prepare a meal that the troops would love, give them what they want, celebrate. And so Captain Winters, then Lieutenant Winters, ordered a big meal of spaghetti and meatballs. And they were in the mess hall, and they were eating spaghetti and meatballs, just loving it. Spooning food. You know, imagine Army soldiers are eating quickly. They're loving it. They're talking about it. And all of a sudden, Captain Sobel steps in and says, "Put your trays down. Get in PT gear. We're running to Currahee." So with all stomachs full of pasta and meatballs, you can imagine, right? The troops start running up the hill to Currahee. Needless to say, when these men finished with their training, they hated Captain Sobel. They hated him. He proved also to be an incompetent officer when it came to leading troops in a field. But he worked them and worked them and worked them. He made them into the most physically fit soldiers in the entire United States Army. Okay? So, we'll leave that for a minute, and we'll talk about our text this morning, both of them, starting with what I like to refer to as the second gospel in a nutshell. I could talk about this for an hour, so please, my wife will raise her hand if I get going too long, I'm sure, tell me to knock it off, but I could talk about this forever. St. Paul, ordinary human being, a man who was very in keeping with the ideas of other people around him. He followed the law like any good Pharisee would. He followed the worldly teachings of his Jewish contemporaries. He thought of himself as literally being a Pharisee among Pharisees. And then he's brought to faith in Jesus. On the road to Damascus, he's brought to faith in Christ. And the Lord starts using that same zeal that he had in condemning the church and persecuting Christians and arresting them, having them thrown in jail, killing them. The Lord starts using that same zeal to promote the gospel. And we know that St. Paul was sent away by the Lord for a while. He spent 14 years away. And during that time, the Lord gave him direct revelation. All we see in the New Testament, I mean, 2/3 of the entire New Testament given by direct revelation to St. Paul. And he talks tongue-in-cheek about this man that he knows, which, without reservation or doubt, is St. Paul himself. This man who had been taken up to the third heaven. He had seen things that no other human being had been allowed to see. Things you couldn't even talk about that would not even make sense to you and I if you were to talk about them. The things he saw in the presence of God in heaven. And so St. Paul, he says, you know, I could boast about that, and I could boast about that man, but I'm not. And he goes on to say something that is really very relevant in our lives, all of our lives. He says, in order to keep me from becoming proud, full of myself, overconfident in my abilities that I've been given, the Lord allowed a thorn in my flesh to be given to me. And again, we could talk for a half hour on the thorn. What is it? It doesn't matter. We don't know, and that's a good thing we don't know. What we do know is that St. Paul, because of his human frailties, his fallenness, he was tempted, like we all are, to either be puffed up with pride or to be down in the mouth over despair. And his tendency was toward pride. And man, anybody would have been full of themselves if they were given the special treatment that God gave him and allowed to see the things that God allowed him to see in order to carry the gospel to the church and to the world. And St. Paul says, matter of fact, in order to keep my pride in check, which would become a hindrance to the gospel, would be something that would keep me from receiving the grace of my Lord and seeing how much I need Jesus each and every day, this tormentor was given me. Something was given to him. St. Paul had an affliction. Something that wouldn't go away. And this is where I'd like you to think about yourself. What would be the one affliction that would hit you hardest? What would be the one affliction that would hit you right where it hurts? And imagine that's probably the thorn that St. Paul was given. And we don't know what it is. But it was given specifically so that he would not rely on himself, but would rely on the gospel. Nothing but Christ crucified and risen for the life of the world. So that he would see that his talents, his gifts don't set him apart from anybody else. They don't make him any different than anybody else or any more ready to receive the gospel or better suited to receive the gospel or more qualified or fitting to receive the grace of our Lord. None of those things. 3 times St. Paul went to the Lord and said, please take this away. I can't stand it. It's horrible. Take it away. And out of his love, his abundant, bless you, his unbelievable love for Paul and for his church, the Lord said no. I'm not going to take away that thorn. I'm not going to take away your affliction. You need it. Without it, you wouldn't need me. My grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in your weakness. The strength of the crucified and risen Lord is nowhere more clearly felt to be needed than when we are lying on the ground totally defeated. And so St. Paul says, I get it now, I get it. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about those things in life that everybody else says, man, God must be against you. God must not like you. God must not hear your prayers. God must be mad at you for something. No. He said, no. God loves me. He loves me so much, he helps me see each and every day that his grace is sufficient for me. And he does that like he does for all of us through the thorns in our flesh, lest we be unable to see him and know our need for his gifts. Okay? Carrie's raising her hand. No, she's not. We could talk about that longer, but you see the point of this wonderful passage. Well, now we go to Mark chapter 6. St. Paul's problem, remember, was fallen nature and how fallen nature interrupts or gets in the way of God's grace in Christ and us being able to see it and see our need for it. Well, the same thing was happening in Nazareth. Now, this account is interesting. We sang Robin's hymn. Robin's hymn touched upon the fact, I think from Luke 4, that this is where It doesn't tell us in Mark 6, but this is probably the same account where Jesus gets up in the synagogue in Nazareth, talks about the Isaiah passage and says, this has been fulfilled in your hearing. And the crowd has had enough, they get mad and they try and drive him out the edge of town and run him over a cliff. It's probably the same thing. Gives us some other details here. Probably the same event though. What was the problem with the people? They were scandalized by Jesus. They were thinking according to worldly ways. Remember a few weeks ago, the end of the wonderful epistle from 2 Corinthians 5? We no longer as Christians look at others in a worldly way. And I'm paraphrasing, but you remember that passage. The people in Nazareth, they couldn't get past looking at Jesus in a worldly way. Okay? Here's this son of the hometown. And by the way, the word used, it says in verse 3, they took offense at him. It's very fascinating. The word there in Greek is scandalizo. They were scandalized by him. Now, why were they scandalized by Jesus? Think about what they would have known about their hometown boy. There was something a little off about his birth. Something not quite right about how he came into this world. Something a little bit scandalous about his relationship, or his mother's relationship with Joseph, the carpenter, who raised him as his own, right? Something a little off. They were scandalized by Jesus. They had seen him. They had seen him grow up in the community, and he grew up as a normal kid. So any of those stories that you've heard, those apocalyptic stories about Jesus healing or bringing to life a clay bird or healing a kid that falls off a roof when he was... No, that was all nonsense. Jesus grew up as a normal kid in Nazareth with these stories circulating around about his birth and his mother's relationship with Joseph. And we know from church history and tradition that there were stories going on about Mary and a Roman centurion. All false. All false. Those things are all false. But they were scandalized that now this Jesus, this hometown boy, had come back and had been performing all these miracles and talking like he's the Son of God and talking like he's the Messiah. They were scandalized by Jesus because they just didn't want to see it. They were caught up in their worldly way of thinking about things, and they just couldn't get past the way they thought according to their fallen nature to see Jesus for who he truly is. To see him as the Messiah, the one God had promised to send and now was there in his hometown proclaiming the kingdom of God. And you notice in this account from Mark, Jesus was not able to perform hardly any miraculous deeds. Now, why was that? Was somehow God, his power as God, was it somehow muted? No. We know from every healing that Jesus did, every time he does a miracle, he comments, their faith has made them well. Their faith has caused them to be healed. Their faith was at the center of everything good that happened. The reason Jesus wasn't performing miracles in Nazareth, with the exception of just a few, is because the people were so blinded by their worldly fallen way of looking at things and at him. They had no faith. He was marveling at their unbelief. And because of their lack of faith, they had no benefits of the gospel. They had no benefits of his grace, no benefits of his mercy. You see, these two accounts go hand in glove because they both remind us that it's worldly fallen thinking that keeps us from being made ready for our room. The Lord has prepared our room. It's done. Jesus the Christ, the Son of God in human flesh, has done everything necessary for our salvation. It is done. But are you ready for your room? The devil, the world, and our sinful flesh are constantly doing everything they can to put up obstacles, to put up things between us and the Lord to make our attention be diverted away from the grace of Christ and the way God thinks about things and looks at things to the way the world looks at things and how worldly wisdom would see things. Constantly wants us to get puffed up with pride like St. Paul struggled with, or to get down in the dumps over despair, focusing on ourselves and whether we're good enough or not good enough. Constantly tempting us to look at the world the way the world looks at things, the way the world wants to see things, regarding relationships and creation and all of the things that God would have us know as revealed in His Word. Unbelief is the enemy to recognizing our Lord and seeing who He is. And the devil is constantly working to stir up unbelief in all of us because he wants us back. We belong to Christ and he wants us back. Now, I mentioned at the start of this the account of Easy Company and Captain Herbert Sobel and how just really hated. You shouldn't talk about hating church, but he was hated by his men. They despised him. But at the end of that wonderful book, if you read it, and I encourage you to read the book, Band of Brothers, and then watch the miniseries. At the end of that book, the author, Stephen Ambrose, is talking to the hero of Easy Company, Captain Richard Winters. On 4th of July, you couldn't have a better story about American heroism and all the things that go with it than Captain Richard Winters. But Captain Winters, when he's asked about Sobel, Captain Sobel, and how the men disliked him, he said, yeah, it's true. They hated him. We couldn't wait to get rid of him. Couldn't wait to be away from him. But here's the deal. We would have never made it through Europe without him putting us through what he put us through. We needed that. We needed that terribly hard training. We needed that terribly difficult situation. We needed all of that running up that mountain day in, day out, night and day, because it prepared us for what we went through at D-Day and through the rest of the war. We needed the difficulties, the struggles, the hardships. Interesting. We learned from our two texts this morning, from 2 Corinthians and from Mark 6, that God is constantly at work in our lives, destroying the things that the devil, the world, and our sinful flesh would use as obstacles. In Lutheranism, we call them idols. Obstacles to grace and faith. Things that divert our attention away from the only thing that is necessary, Christ's grace, His forgiveness, life, and salvation. God is constantly at work tearing down those idols. And you know what? That's the stuff that hurts. That's the part of life that's uncomfortable. That's the part of life we don't want to go through. It's what our Lutheran confessions talked about, God doing His strange and unusual work in us in order so that we can see our need for His work of Christ in us, His work of forgiveness, life, and salvation in us. It's like Hebrews 12, the chapter on discipline. God disciplines us. He uses those difficult moments in life to shake us free from the things that the devil, the world, and our sinful flesh would have us focus on, so that we can see, as St. Paul, that Christ's grace truly is sufficient for us. Dear pastor I knew once told me that through all his life's ups and downs, focusing especially on the difficult nature of the struggles and trials he went through, that he could always look in life's rearview mirror and see the cross of Christ. In other words, Jesus was constantly reminding him, as he's constantly reminding us, that his grace is sufficient for us. Happy 4th of July, everybody. In Jesus' name, amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds forever in Christ Jesus. and his grace unto life everlasting. Amen. Rejection in this world. You lead us likewise through a hostile world that shows no honor to your church or its wisdom given by you. Do not let us lose heart. Steel us for opposition, and let us rest confidently on what you, Lord, have said and done. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Holy God, your great and mighty work is to create faith by your Holy Spirit in the eternal blessings of your Son, Jesus Christ. We implore you, make your preachers effective to proclaim your prophetic word, and remove all stubborn ears from our midst. Do not leave us without your word, but make your home among us, and restore the joy of your salvation in us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, soften the hearts in every home. Turn parents and children toward each other in love and patience. Banish the spirit of impudence, stubbornness, and rebellion from us all. Sanctify us in your truth, reminding us always that your grace in Christ is sufficient. Lord, in your mercy, Almighty God, protect and defend our nation from its enemies. Support our leaders and preserve them from temptation. Through the work of all civil authorities, enable us to live quiet and peaceful lives according to your word. Lord, in your mercy, gracious Lord, in our weakness we are strong for the sake of Christ, whose grace is sufficient for every need. Give comfort to those whose pain is chronic, whose sustained suffering is unknown, who wrestle with difficult forms in body or mind, or who are tempted to despair or to pride. Hear our prayers for Paula, Priscilla, Tim, Susan, the whole Johanning family. And hear all our prayers now as we mention those for whom we pray in our hearts to you, Lord. In weakness, insults, hardship, and persecutions, and calamities, let us boast in Christ and his cross, by which we and our suffering are sanctified. Lord, in your mercy, O Lord, out of your abundant blessing, you satisfy us with Christ, the bread of life. Give repentance and faith to all who commune this day, that finding refuge in your Son's true body and blood, we may taste and see that you are good. Lord, in your mercy, all these things and whatever else you know that we need, grant us, Heavenly Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Please be seated. We sing our closing hymn for this morning, God Bless Our Native Land, 965.
Mm-hmm.
those who served in our nation to stand up and be recognized and thanked for that. And we'll go more or less alphabetical. Air Force, if you're in the Air Force, please stand up. Thank you very much. If you were in the Army, please stand up. If you were in the Coast Guard, please stand up. If you were in the Marine Corps, please stand up. And if you were in the Navy, please stand up. Thank you for your service, everybody. Just a few announcements. We're going to go enjoy some goodies. Church Council meets this Tuesday at 6 o'clock here at church. LWML meets this Wednesday, July 7th at 1 o'clock here at church. Choir meets Wednesday at 6. We will have Holy Communion for those who are not yet feeling comfortable being in church. We do have that at 6:45 on Wednesday here at church. Wednesday Bible study, we're reading our book, Grace Upon Grace, is at 7. We're just starting a brand new book on Thursday Morning Book Club. Wonderful book. I invite you to please read the summary. It's a little lengthy, but it's very relevant for our day and age. A wonderful book. We're going to start that on Thursday at 8:30 in the morning. Men's Club meets Friday, July 9th, 8 o'clock. We'll have our Bible study and time together here, our meeting, and then we'll go for breakfast down with the pasta. And then Friday morning Bible study at 10:30, Galatians, Philippians, and Colossians. I mentioned our prayers and thoughts for Priscilla and the whole family. And again, that funeral service is at Riverside United Methodist on Tuesday the 6th at 11 a.m. Don't forget Vacation Bible School, the last week of the month, and our retreat on Friday the 23rd on Regrets, Reality, and Restoration. Finally, before the choirs helps us sing, as we move, we're going to continue our Issues, Etc. Bible study this morning on cultural Marxism. So, did I forget anything?
I just want to let everyone know that Taste of Dorset is coming the first Sunday of August. So please think about coming and helping. We're going to need help. The church will be there with our corn. So thank you.
Thanks, Rick. Anything else?
Please join us in singing American Beauty.
Please join the choir and sing America the Beautiful. Happy 4th of July, everybody. God bless. Yeah.